Who can say it better than Jesus? This is our compass. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another, just as I have loved you. You also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. So Jesus' teachings were about love. When I was in seminary, I was talking about non-duality. You know, Charles Fillmore talked about oneness to a fellow student, and this fellow student said, well, what good is that to be a minister? You don't want to talk about enlightenment as a minister. What good is it? It's just confusing. And I'm like, Unio Mystica is what the Catholics called it. Theosis is what the Greek Orthodox called it. If you read the writings from any mystic of any tradition in the world, it's all the same. It doesn't matter if it's from a Sufi, Buddhist, Hindu, Christian, you name it. Non-duality is the experience of the presence of God. We call that, you know, mystic. It can be a slippery slope. If you think you're a mystic, ooh, you know, you can be special. And that is a slippery slope. So, you know, why? What's the value in it? Well, if Fillmore, which was, you know, one of the co-founders of this movement, talked about oneness on a regular basis, maybe we should pay attention. So this series, Spirituality's Fab Four, I've been studying devotional non-duality since 05. David Hawkins is my teacher. Jesus Christ is my teacher. But in this generation, David Hawkins speaks English, wrote 10, 12 books on non-duality, is a mystic, has transitioned, and I've been a student of his. I see perfect concordance with the teachings of Jesus Christ and every mystic, the Buddha, Krishna, all of them. And so I see how it's so perfect in unity, how unity embraces the truth from every tradition. We don't want to be prejudicial towards any one tradition over another. There's truth everywhere, so we honor the truth everywhere. Amen? So as I was studying devotional non-duality and studying the world's religions, what's the most succinct takeaway? How can you boil it down to the most simple of all spiritual practices? You know, when I was speaking on the Sermon on the Mount, the commentators that wrote all those were calling the Sermon on the Mount the compendium of Jesus' teachings, which is the synopsis of all he had really taught for 3.5 years are consolidated into Matthew 5, 6, and 7. So if you want pure Jesus, Matthew 5, 6, and 7, you're gonna get the lion's share of what he spent most of his time teaching the apostles, the disciples, okay? So when I look at, and I try to simplify even that, what are the most simple, common threads of all the world's great spiritual teachers, and I came up with this list of four. And the order almost doesn't matter, because each spiritual practice lends itself to the next, which lends itself to the next and to the next. And you have this spiral of continued, seamless, endless growth that will raise us from one level of consciousness or one zip code to another zip code, okay? So that's why I'm gonna talk about these today. Okay, and again, 3 weeks ago I started with devotion. I did a talk all on devotion. Well, I'm gonna do a quick little recap because it's so integral to these four practices. Make sense? Okay, let's go. Got our seatbelts? Okay, so the most important thing, as we read from Jesus' teaching, the new commandment I give to you, love one another. Well, how do we get to love? How can we get to love? How can we get to unconditional love? And that's a series of talks in and of itself, but there are practices that we can do. So in the context of love, devotion begins to really make sense. If you're devoted to building muscles, then you're going to be in the gym. If you're devoted to the experience of the presence of God, you're going to find these, you're going to find resonance in these teachings, all right? So, remember I did the talk last week about the ridgeline? It was a vision that I'd had years ago, and I found this sketch that I had sketched years ago, forgot I even sketched it in one of my, in my sandwich between a couple of books in my office. So I'm going to get into that sketch a couple times today. But one thing about devotion, it keeps us on that ridge line, the straight and narrow path. Straight and narrow is the path, waste no time. The path to what? I believe unconditional love is, dare I say, attainable in this lifetime. It's not too lofty of a goal. Enlightenment, yes. And if you set enlightenment as a goal, then it employs the ego to grasp, which it can't do. This whole business of spirituality as opposed to religion is relaxing into our true essence, capital E essence, which is the Christ, the living Christ within, the Holy Spirit. That's our true eternal nature. We're stuck inside of an animal. From this animal, we work out our progression through the zip codes until we can surrender completely identification as an animal, as a Homo sapien, and then we can relax into Homo spiritus. Is this okay? It's not too lofty or anything, right? This is cool. Okay. So it keeps us on the narrow ridge line. Okay, so when I was talking about this before, we see this, I don't know if it makes sense, but on the left side here, we have what looks dirty. It's a plateau. It's like stepping off this platform. As we step off the platform onto this narrow ridge line, it's the narrow path. And then we see a couple little peaks along the way where there's a little increase in the grade. Now, one thing about this beginning path is you're barefoot, by the way. And the ridge line is very smooth because billions of people have walked on that ridge line. That's the beginning journey of the spiritual, well, maybe hundreds of millions, I don't know. I never did the math. So it's the beginning of the spiritual journey, and a lot of people have walked on it and worn it smooth, so you feel it's very comfortable to walk on. And as we go over that first little peak, things begin to change. We notice that the ridge line is a little more coarse. Fewer feet have worn it down. A little more coarse. Okay. And then as we move on to the next one, little peak, it even gets more coarse. I don't want to get too much into this. I touched on it last week. One thing about devotion. We can come in and like Wednesdays or Thursday mornings, we have these devotional stations set up. And we can experience communion with the divine, or we can toss a cracker and a grape in our mouth. It can be meaningless and routine, or it can be really deeply moving. It can be a deep experience. It's up to the ego, which is kind of the gatekeeper. So it can be a pathway of dedication or routine. We choose. So one thing about this slide, I'll go back to it here, is if it's routine, we find ourselves settling into the trees. See the trees below the ridgeline there? And that's okay. If we get off the straight and narrow, because I got to tell you, when you're up on that ridge, it's windy. You're subject to the elements. There's no shelter. What I saw in the trees were there are these little huts, little houses, little campfires, little smoke coming out the chimney, and the smoke was able to trickle up softly because it was out of the wind, and it was very comfortable. So there are seasons in our life when we get off the straight and narrow just to relax, go to the beach, hang out, have a barbecue, catch your wind, catch your breath. Some of us do that for three lifetimes, but then we get back on the journey. Okay, so it's okay, but I don't know that you want to hang out there, because I don't know that you're going to experience oneness in the trees. You know, the tree, I was curious about the tree level. Down in the Southwest, it's at about 5,000 feet. So when you're up about 5,000 feet, the trees stop growing. Up in the Northwest, where I come from, it's about 7,000 feet. I know, because I used to work at a ski resort, right, where the trees got this short and then they stopped, and I could look straight across at Mount Rainier and see where I was, and there were no trees up above. It's because the environment is not conducive to the comfortable life. Trees need conditions where it's comfortable for them to grow, to mature. We can only go as we are drawn, as we allow the spirit within us to come forth. That becomes the needle in our compass. That's what we follow. That's the source of devotion, is the Holy Spirit within that draws us to itself, the Heavenly Father. Union with the divine, unio mystica, the mystical union of oneness with the divine, with God. Okay? That's the only Latin I really know. I love what Wayne Dyer said about the ego, edging God out. Jesus taught the principle of displacement. If we allow the ego to win, then we can't experience that draw to the divine. Our compass needle is kind of all over the place because we've blocked ourselves from the magnetic north, if you will. So humility prevents falling off the path. The pride that can come on. Now this is the second, I used to call it the pillars, but this is the second Fab Four, is humility. It's so vitally important to not be special. As I was saying before, if we've had a mystical experience, doesn't necessarily mean you're an advanced mystic. I interpret an advanced mystic as somebody that's in non-duality and never comes back. Never, the ego has died. And they're just walking, streaming consciousness, and they speak from Holy Spirit. So when you read Meister Eckhart, a Catholic mystic from, I can't remember, 1500s, I can't remember, but it's really weird, and he almost, you know, was smoked because it seemed blasphemous that he was speaking as God. When Jesus said, I and the Father are one, he was trying to dumb it down, simplify it so that we could get it. Again, his audience were not like the folks in the East, where enlightenment was a common teaching. In the Middle East, it was much more primal, if you will, not as highly evolved. And so he had to simplify the teachings. Okay, so humility prevents us from our pride, which is the slippery slope that'll take us right off the narrow ridge line. Take us right out of it. The reason there's this correlation, if we have enough pride to where we have to put up a puffy front and protect something, and then when that something is exposed, then we become embarrassed. And embarrassment is couched in shame. And if we have, well, I'll get to that in just a moment, but we don't want to abandon the spiritual journey. So humility is vitally important to keep us on that narrow path. Okay, now other things about humility. It doesn't whine about the journey. There's no whining in spirituality. Not if we want to move on. But if we want to settle in the trees, whining is fine. It's okay, come on down to the trees and settle and relax. Whining is fine. There's no victimhood on the ridgeline where the nasty weather and big winds are. But we can be victims down below in the settlements. And again, I don't want to trash relaxing off the ridgeline. It's okay. It's okay. But I think to follow Jesus' commandment of loving one another, I think there's some work to do on that ridgeline to get us there. Because what's coming is this insurmountable peak that is inverted. And if you're barefoot and have no tools, and there's sheer cliffs on both sides, there's only one way over. And that's through surrender, and that's coming up next. So, this is really important. Humility is immune to fear because it has nothing to defend. Only the ego needs to defend itself. The animal nature will snarl and growl to protect its space. Because if it doesn't have enough to eat, it won't survive. So the animal nature is based on sustenance for survival. We're eternal beings if we can relax into our true essence, spirit, and there's nothing to wrestle about. The Holy Spirit brings all the things we need into our life at the appropriate time. When we live a life completely surrendered to spirit, we hoist that sail and let go of the rudder. It's shocking how many times things show up immediately when it's needed. I heard a great teacher once say, "I don't need all these tools. I just need the tool I need for the day." So if we try to hoard tools, and he was a healer, a faith healer. And having been around a few, some are, they flow in healing, man. They're in that zip code where miracles and healings take place, and I'll show you where that is. But it's over on the other side of the peak, okay? So it takes some surrendering and whatnot to get there, humility and surrender. So the reason we don't have to defend the ego is because if we can identify with the true self, Holy Spirit, that's like a big God right behind us. Through us, it permeates our being because it is our essence. We're just wearing this Halloween costume. So when we can relax into our essence, which is the Holy Spirit, that's infinitely powerful. We have nothing to defend at that point. So you can walk into the bullets of rejection or accusations or somebody's criticism. Okay, yeah, I can take that, because if I'm not defending me being Johnny Spiritual or Mr. Right, and I can say, well, yeah, I'm flawed. I'm on the journey. I'm not there. I've got a ways to go. If we can accept that, laugh at ourselves, enjoy, you know, the journey and our foibles, it's okay. Be patient with ourselves. Laugh at ourselves. It's all good. Okay, so now, surrender. Okay, first, to start the whole thing requires that first step of surrender. We have to surrender to the living presence. We have to surrender. The ego has to step aside and say, okay, God, I accept you as a reality, and that I want to follow you. I want to follow you, Holy Spirit, whatever your name is for God. I want to experience peace. I want to experience love. I want a great life. That's the other thing. In, you know, Hawkins' research, he was a psychiatrist for 50 years. He did a correlation between the zip code that people are in and their percentage of time they're in happiness. People that are in love, the zip code of love, are happy 90% of the time. Once an individual, which is only 4 people out of 100 live in a zip code of love. Now, to get to unconditional love, which was Jesus' teachings, love your enemies, unconditional love, only 4 people in 1,000 get there. 4 in 1,000. That's rare, but they're happy 99% of the time. Why not make it our goal to get to unconditional love? I'm signing up for that. Okay, so surrender is the way. That's what they called the early church, the first century of, before it was called Christianity. It was the way. It's the way of it, as Byron Katie says. It's the way of it. We surrender, constantly surrender our position, our ego defense. It's just the way it is. And in order to transcend any zip code, identification with any person that I used to be, it requires a surrender. I highly recommend the book Letting Go. If you've not read it, we had a book study here about a year or two ago. Letting Go. Fantastic. It gives all sorts of practical application of how to surrender attachments so that we can let go of our suffering. Because being attached or to be averse, to be afraid of something to the point where it controls you, or attached to something where it controls you, you've lost your opportunity for joy. These things outside of you now control your experience. That makes sense? So we let go attachments and aversions, okay? So we can be free in Christ. All right, so now, I might get in hot water on this one. The problem with new thought, and this is a new thought, church. The problem with new thought are thoughts. It utilizes thinking. So there's a limit to what the practice of new thought can bring us. And I'll get more into this later. But you can't use the ego to pole vault over the ego. Pole vault's not the best term because it uses muscle. But to transcend the ego, you can't employ the ego. It doesn't have that in its nature. That's the job of spirit. So we relax the ego and rest in spirit to rise above ego. So the reason I ended up in Unity, I visited a number of other New Thought churches, and they kind of dismissed Jesus in such a way that there was an arrogance, there was a specialness. And I don't ever want to dismiss any of the avatars. Man, they're fully enlightened. Who am I to question any great teacher? Jesus is cool, but it's his friends I'm a little worried about. So, but some metaphysicians think that it's because of them and their thinking that they healed themselves and me, I. Well, that employs the ego. Does that make sense? Well, Myrtle Fillmore took it to the next level. You know, she heard E.B. Weeks give a talk, and E.B. Weeks was a New Thought teacher, and her takeaway was, I am a child of God, therefore I do not inherit sickness. And her daily practice was to sit with a chair in front of her, and she would visualize Jesus in that chair, and she would meditate with Jesus. Jesus was her teacher. Charles Fillmore said Jesus Christ is the head of this school, the head of this church. So she employed the linear thinkingness of the mind, and yet she opened herself up to the teachings of Jesus. Love, the teachings of love, non-linear. Love is the vehicle that gets us over this coming impossible peak that we are to transcend if we're going to be one of the 4% or one of the 0.04% to experience unconditional love. So she kind of really shifted the whole New Thought movement. Her healing of tuberculosis sent a shockwave through. Unity began having a prayer ministry, which to this day, 125 years on, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, you can pray with somebody at Silent Unity. And then they'll continue to pray for you for 60 days. Do we trust a friendly universe? You know, I think it was Einstein said something like, the consciousness that got us into a problem isn't going to get us out of the problem. We'll need a higher consciousness. So again, what Myrtle's practice of meditating with Jesus was the catapult to bring her, to lift her spiritually beyond the ego's limit. So she relaxed into her divine essence as her source. So again, the tree line can be very enticing, and it's okay to take that break, but we move on. So this is where we're headed, the peak. Myrtle Fillmore got over that peak, and she helped us learn how. Jesus was trying to get everybody over that peak. That peak is the intellect. See the most impossible one that goes backwards like that? That looks like Whoville, the Seuss diagram. You can't do it with the intellect. The intellect needs to be surrendered. One must retreat, back up, repent or repeat, just back up, change directions from what you have been doing, and then just take that leap of faith into love. The nonlinear is love. It's trust. The only way we can get beyond this is through surrender. The ego, the intellect, will give you 73 reasons why I've got a headache right now. I told you years ago when I used to be in the Philippines, you know, we prayed for a lot of people and healings all the time. It was really cool. But then I could just go like, oh, take away this headache. It'd be gone. You know, it's so funny because I've only twice in 6 years had a really painful migraine. But I woke up this morning with a nice one right through. And I mentioned before, I took way too many of those aspirin that have caffeine in them, so I'm really buzzing. So if I'm a little too chatty, let me know afterwards. Just don't throw anything. Okay, so the path. The Unio Mystica, by the way, you see the little threshold of light. That's what has to happen to get to non-duality. And there's only like 1 in 10 million that go through that threshold. So Jesus' teachings, if we just get to unconditional love, we're on a tractor beam to get there. Don't need to worry about the rest of the way. Non-duality is inevitable if we can get to unconditional love. Make sense? Because we're above the attachment identification of linear thinkingness. So new thought is great, but embrace Myrtle Fillmore's example of bringing in the Christ. See, God is both immanent, the essence of our nature is Holy Spirit, eternal already, can't die, dead. You have a life. You cannot not exist if you exist. It's a brain teaser. If you exist, you cannot not exist. It's not characteristic of the universe to swallow energy, and life is energy. So, okay. The fourth practice, the fourth of the Fab Four, are contemplative practices. And again, the order of which really doesn't matter, but they complement each other. Contemplative practices, I don't care if it's meditation, centering prayer, reading a scripture and just sitting with it and mulling it over like a cow chewing a cud. Any great teaching that we sit with, keep it on our mind as we go about and do our vacuuming and our chores. I was a custodian for a few years and I loved it because my mind was free to experience Christ, to experience the presence. And then I got a job, white collar job, and oh my gosh, all day would go by and my mind was occupied all day long. What a drag, I felt like I was in prison. Thank God for the custodians, amen. So, I think that contemplative practice act as an antivirus for our harmful thinkingness. So new thought has tremendous truth in it. I don't want to poo-poo new thought, because if our mind is stuck on stinking thinking, you know, we can get really stuck. We can think all those accusations. If any of us grew up in a dysfunctional home where we were told we were nothing, no good, nobody, yada, 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 and that wasn't my experience. But whenever we were really shamed, psychologically, we bring that in to protect us from being hurt by that again. And so we shame ourselves. The inner parent is usually more severe than the parents we ever had because we want to protect ourselves from getting our hands slapped. Basic psychology. So meditation gives us traction along the ridgeline. And again, each of these practices facilitates the next. They all work together for the highest good and lifting us up to a place of unconditional love. I really believe that. If we can practice loving ourselves, then it gets a lot easier to love the people around us. All right? So the meditation practices, this is what Fillmore showed us, taught us, is that by doing these meditative practices, it reprograms our subconscious mind. So we can practice the prayer affirmations and denials, and our intentions, and then daily letting go. Christ's mind can come and reprogram our hard disk. And then the last slide is a call to action, everybody. We got a call to action. The old salesman's getting up to close. Practice the Fab Four. They'll help us follow Jesus' command to love one another. But you only have to do this if you want a great life. If you don't want a great life, don't do this stuff. Well, let's have a great life. All right. God, thank you so much for the gift of life, for this journey that we're on, for the love of the Christ that inhabits every soul. God, we choose to have the ego step aside so the love of the Holy Spirit can pour forth to every soul we meet. May everybody we meet experience the love of God through us. Thank you, God. Amen.